Sunday. I hope you've brought your warm hearts to this morning service, and I'd love to invite you to come and sing with us about our wonderful God that, I think He stirs our souls and stirs our hearts. So let's just glorify Him.
And they proclaim, my God, how great. Good morning, everyone. Let's give Marlise and the band a big hand. This is wonderful. Thank you so much, guys. Well, good morning, all, and thank you for joining us on this very fresh morning. I'm sure it's safe to say that winter's here, and I'm very happy to see all of these beautiful faces this morning. Are there any new visitors here for the very first time? Oh, there we go. Let's give this lovely lady a hand. Jan is going to give you a mug just to welcome you, and we hope and we pray that you find your spiritual home with us. Welcome so much. Anyone else? Nothing? Oh, there we go. A gentleman in the back. Yeah, we saw you. Jan? Daar in die hoek, daar meneer daar. This is really wonderful seeing you all. Yaku, welcome back. Good to see you again. All right, we'd like to remind you, let's start at the beginning. We welcome Claude all the way from Botswana. See, we've got some international speakers here this morning. See, this church is really going places. Claude, welcome. Welcome, sir. Claude will be sharing his testimony and his message with us. What does the new covenant mean for you? Now, I personally am very excited, and we trust and we hope and we pray that Claude will be anointed this morning in sharing his testimony with us. Right, I'd like to remind you all, we have our next praise and worship service, our praise and worship and testimony service. They've proved to be quite popular with our congregants. We've got our next one on the 30th of June. So if there's anyone who would like to share their personal message, the message that God has touched their lives with us, just get in touch with either myself or Elise Marie in the back. She's the one that's running around all over the show. And we can get you a spot just to share your message with your fellow brothers and sisters on what the Lord has done for you in your life. And then next up, let's see, also on the 30th of June, after the praise and worship service, we'll be having our first family braai for the year. We haven't had a braai in a long time, so that'll commence after the praise and worship service on the 30th, downstairs in the yellow hall there by the braai area. Please come join us. It's always proven to be big fun. Okay. The boss has shouted. Oh, yes, sign-up sheets, yes. So for the family braai, we'd just like to get to know how many people we can expect, just to get the burries and the buns as well. So there's a sign-up sheet next to the tithes and offerings box. So if you plan to join us on the 30th, just put down your name and how many people you'll be bringing so that we can just be prepared with the amount of food. Okay, and then there will be normal cell groups and kids ministry today. The kids ministry is in the yellow hall as always. And the kids ministry will conclude today for this quarter. So that'll be the last kids ministry for the rest of the quarter, where the school holidays will be commencing next week. I don't know what I'm going to do with my son for 3 weeks, but that's my problem. And then finally, tithes and offerings. There's a tithes box in the back and the box in the front. So let's pray. Benevolent Father, Heavenly Lord, you are praised, you are worshipped. Thank you so much for bringing these wonderful people into your house this morning. We pray that every heart will be touched by Claude's message, that Claude be anointed and blessed in every word that he speaks, that he may be used as a vessel for your message. Thank you, Lord, that we may be called your children and that you are our Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are welcome to stand with us, and let's praise the Lord and let's sing about his goodness. Let's stand.
Grateful man. Forever God is with us.
Praise the Lord.
Oh,
point with this morning we want to worship Him, where we come to a point where we quiet our minds, quiet our souls, so that we can really open up, hear what He has got to say, really come and give our all to Him, our best to worship Him.
To see my sin upon Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give the band a hand. Well done, guys. Excellent this morning. As you hear, most probably know by now, my name is Claude Jarrard. I'm a member of this church, and for the past couple of months I've been working in, I would like to say, outside of the country, and it sounds much more, awesome or great, but it's actually in Botswana. It's closer than Durban, so it's a long-term contract. But I'm privileged to be there. I'm privileged to work there. And today I'm going to speak about a new covenant. I would think most of you know what the new covenant is about, and why I chose this topic this morning. It's just something that happened to me about a month and a half ago in Botswana, that I really realized what the new covenant was about, what Jesus was about. But before I start, let's just close our eyes in prayer. God, we thank you this morning. We thank you that we can be here. We thank you that you're our God, as we heard in this song. We thank you that you took our sin to the cross. You took it to the cross, and you took it on you. Because that's what the new covenant is about. That is why Jesus came. That's what we celebrated 2 months ago during Easter, Lord. On Easter Sunday, when Jesus rose from the dead, on the Friday before that, when he was crucified for what we should have been crucified. But you decided differently. You decided to send your son, Lord. And that's what it's all about. That's all that we need. That's all that we need. So this morning, I'd just like to ask your spirit to be here. You ask your spirit to teach. Ask your spirit to bring the message, Lord. Ask your spirit to open each and every heart. Because we cannot hear without your spirit. We cannot be taught without your spirit, Lord. Because the Bible says we've got hearts of stone. So turn that into hearts of flesh, Lord, but turn our spiritual ears on this morning. I thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, as I said, about a month and a half ago, I'm still in Botswana. And I really went through some trials and tribulations. And as I said, one morning at about 3 o'clock, I just realized again what Jesus means to us and what the Spirit means to us. And what that's the only thing that we do need. So I want to go to the first slide there in the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah talks about the new covenant. Some people, sometimes I hear, and I'm sure you hear the same, you hear things like God in the Old Testament, God in the New Testament, God in the Old Testament, you know, was strict, and God in the New Testament is love and Jesus. But God has been God all along. God did not change. It's we as people that change. So God came to Abraham and he concluded a covenant with him. That was the first covenant. Now, today we don't use that word anymore. We would most probably say today he concluded a contract. Perhaps there would have been some lawyers around. Obviously it didn't work like that. It doesn't work like that with God. But let's read what the prophet Jeremiah writes about 600 years before Christ. So we need to take this into context, people. About 600 years before Christ, God reveals this to the prophet. He says, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant. They broke my covenant. Though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I'll make with the people of Israel. After that time, declares the Lord, I will put my law in their minds and I'll write it in their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people." So God knows at that time that there will be a new covenant. He's talking in essence, the prophet is in essence talking about Jesus Christ. He's in essence talking about that new covenant that Jesus Christ is about. So let's just stand a bit still on how come. How come there was a need for that new covenant? It's because the Israelites broke the old covenant. Let's remember the story. You guys know the story. They were a couple of days out of Egypt. And Moses went up to the mountain. They were left alone for a couple of days. And what did they do? They built a calf. I remember when I was in Sunday school, we were taught about that calf. And we had drawings of it. And some or other Tani told us about, or taught us about that. Why? Because they broke that covenant. That covenant was not in their hearts. Now, Jeremiah talks here about that the covenant will be written in our hearts. What was he talking about? He was talking about the Holy Spirit. He was talking about the Holy Spirit that will change your stone heart into a heart of flesh. So he was referring to that. In the Old Testament, he was referring to that. So, again, what I'm trying to say is God always had a plan. God always had a plan to what... Sometimes, I remember years ago, I attended a Bible school. And one night, one of the pastors that presented, he put up this. He stood like this. He said, "What's this? What's this?" Now, obviously, it's a trick question because everybody going to the Bible school knew that this is a Bible, okay? So it's not that we didn't know the answer, but it was loaded, the question. What's this? Oh, somebody said it's a Bible. He says, "I know it's a Bible." He says, "But this is actually Plan B." Then he caught my ear. This is Plan B. How can this be Plan B? How can this be Plan B? And he started with what I spoke about there, when God led his people out of Egypt into the promised land, and out of that Jesus Christ was born. And he described the Old Testament as a way how God protected the bloodline of Jesus Christ, for Jesus Christ to be born and for us to be saved. Then I figured out while he was saying this was Plan B, because obviously man sinned. So it was so important for God to already, when speaking to his prophets, for his prophets to prophesy about Jesus Christ. And now there's hundreds of Harry is here, my big friend Harry, my good friend, not big, my good friend Harry. Harry, how many prophecies are there in the Old Testament about Jesus? More than 360. If you want an expert on those prophecies, to speak to Harry. 360 prophecies in the Old Testament about Jesus Christ. This is one of them. This is one of them. This is one of them. So God comes and reveals the so-called plan to Jeremiah. Now I want to stand still about, as I said, this morning is actually a bit of a testimony about myself. What happened to me? I'm on this project. And we work as it's a finance project. So obviously we work with a lot of data files and a lot of data. And about 2 months into the project, one day, our computer crashes. There's nothing, just a blue screen. You guys have worked with computers and got some other horrible virus. I got a virus, a computer virus, just a blue screen. Nothing, just a blue screen. Yeah, but I got a backup. Oh, we all have backups. To make a long story, people, short, I phoned my wife, I phoned my daughter. I think my wife said, let's have communion. Let's pray about this. I said, I cannot access this one database in the cloud because it's on an old email address that I don't have the password anymore for. So that's bad planning. So please, if somebody afterwards would like to come and speak to me about better planning your computer and your backups, please. But now, that's not what this is about. So now I've got a client on the one hand shouting for data. I've got a computer, but I just have a blue screen. And my colleagues are shouting for data. And I cannot, and I sit here, I don't know what to do. And I phone my wife and my daughter, and one night we had communion on a Zoom session. Luckily, we borrowed one of their machines. We had a Zoom session, and we had communion. And I remember my wife saying to me, take some anointing oil and anoint the machine. So I was a bit confused about that because I did it. I took anointing oil and I put my hand into the anointing oil and I put my hand onto the machine and I started to pray. And we as a family started to pray. But that next morning after we prayed, 3:00, I woke up. And this is what this is actually about. I just sensed to have communion by myself. And I sat there in front of that machine. I didn't have wine nor fruit juice. I had bread. And had some Coke. I don't know, there's some pastors here that you're allowed to have communion with Coke. I had communion with Coke because it at least it's dark like wine. It looks like red wine if you pour it into a glass. And 3:00 that morning, again put my hand on the machine. I prayed again and I was in deep, deep conversation with the Lord, people. Deep conversation. And I sensed the Lord. I didn't hear him. I read this piece. Luke 25, verse 15. You can just move on there. Yes. Luke 25. Sorry, Luke. I just want to make sure. Luke 22, sorry. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Now this is Jesus Christ, the night before he was crucified, saying this to the people around him. Saying this to them. And he said, in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, the cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. When I read that piece, the cup is the new covenant which is poured out for you with his disciples that night before he got crucified. I sensed the Lord saying to me, this is all that you need. This is all that you need. You need no more. I remember in my back of my mind, I went to my old self and I said, Lord, but my computer is still not working. The computer is still not working. I don't have the data. And I heard again, this is all that you need. This is all that you need. Now people, today my message is actually very simple. All of us have gotten to that point where we battle with stuff. Perhaps it's not your machine. Perhaps you don't have a job. Perhaps something is wrong with your house. Perhaps there's something wrong in your marriage. Jesus says to us, this is all that we need. And then the next verse struck me. And perhaps I've read it before, but that morning at 3:00, it struck me. Let's look at the next verse. Verse 21. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. That struck me that morning, people. It struck me how close Satan is to Jesus. Satan was at the table in the form of Judas. A couple of hours later, he betrayed Jesus. Okay? We all know what happened to Judas. What happened to Judas? Perhaps the small kids that don't know. A couple of hours later, he committed suicide. Death. Death. What did Jesus do a couple of hours later? He died on the cross for us for eternal life. And it struck me that morning to say, how close is the truth to the devil lying to us? So close that Jesus says he's at the table with me. At the table. So this morning, in essence, I want to talk to you about that personal way that Jesus comes to us when he saves us, but also a warning. The warning is at the table with Jesus. He's at the table. Now let's go to where we are today, where we live, where what we do. And let's look at that fine line. You switch on your TV. Some of you have got small kids here. You switch on your TV, you go to Disney Channel. That's a nice thing to do when you don't know what to do with the kids, or they are running around, and perhaps mom and dad wants to have a bit of quiet time, so let's switch on the TV for the kids and let's let them watch Disney Channel. People, those things at the table, that's the table. In today's world, I'm using one thing as an example. The media and entertainment is where the evil one, in this case Satan, gets his foot into us, into our lives, into our houses, with our kids when they are still young. Oh, you watch Little Mermaids. Oh, that's great. It's just a little story on some other Cartoon Network or on Disney. But it's based into some stuff with water spirits. So it's so close. It looks so great. It looks so entertaining. Oh, I can let my kids watch it. So we expose our children to stuff like Jesus says, he's at the table with me. He's at the table. So a warning, people, a warning, ladies and gentlemen, everybody here today, a warning to me, to myself, to my family, to us as men, that are priests in our houses. God gives us, he anoints us differently. He says to us as men, we need to sort these things out. It's our job. It's our job to keep our houses free of these things. It's our job to have the people that stay with us, our wives, our children, whoever might stay in your house. You have a special anointment to make sure that the thief that's sitting at the table is chucked out of your house. Now, that's a bit of slang. Chucked out of your house. That thief should not sit at your table, but he comes there slowly. You don't realize it. You don't acknowledge it. You switch on your phone. You see something. Oh, no. You see something and you look again. Next time you watch again. You're not watching bad stuff, but you're just on that line. Just on that line. And I sat that morning and I realized how close the devil plays towards next to Jesus, that line. How close he is. And I asked myself before, I said, but God, you gave us tools for this. And then I went to, you can go to the next slide, 1 Corinthians 12. Then I went to 1 Corinthians 12 that morning at 3 o'clock, and I remembered the tools God gave us. The tools to combat the evil one. He gave it to us. He says in 1 Corinthians 12, and I'm sure you've read this 100 times, but I'm going to ask you again to read it. Verse 8 to verse 10. About the spiritual gifts. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. So the Bible says God gives us wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith that gives other gifts of healing of that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To other, prophecy. Look up prophecy. What is Jeremiah doing? He's prophesizing. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. Now, I only took 2 verses in 1 Corinthians 12. But go and read the whole chapter, and you'll see the last verse in the chapter. The last verse in the chapter says that the Spirit gives those gifts to whoever he wants. So, you must ask of those gifts from the Spirit. That's what this is about. To ask, to get, to use my slang that I used just now, to chuck the devil out of from your table, in out of your house, out of your life, out of your marriage, out of your job, wherever you work, wherever you are. To distinguish between God, what God is saying, and what the devil is trying to lure you to. To lure you to. So, there God gave us a box of tools. Now, not sure who I've got some tools in my garage, although I don't have very good, nice tools. I can't really work with my hands. But I've got a couple of tools. I've got some pliers. I've got a couple of screwdrivers and a hammer, or whatever. So I've got some tools to fix stuff at my house. God giving us these tools, people. He's giving us these tools to combat or to make sure that we can combat the devil, that we can combat him. Now the next verse, just go to the next slide, please. This is some of you that know me, that worked with me. This is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. And this comes about Revelation 3, verse 19 to 21. So that morning, I realized two things. How close the devil is to Jesus, but how personal God gets, how personal he is. He comes to us personally. And that shows his love for us and shows the relationship that he wants from us and with us. Now let's read Revelation 3 verse 19 to 21. Those whom I love I rebuke and I discipline. Oh, so Jesus says he will discipline us. That's great. So be earnest and repent. I'm going to speak about repentance a bit later. Here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. To the one who is victorious, now there's a promise. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. So he says to us, if we're victorious, he'll give us the right to sit next to his Father on his throne. Now, I read a bit of documentary, let's call it outside of the scriptures, about this piece. Why does Jesus use this example? Why? Why does he use this example of knocking on your heart, knocking on the door? Why? Because at the time, there was a Jewish tradition that when you got married, and most, some of you, especially the older people here, are married, when you got married, Now listen what was the tradition. The father of the groom and the groom went to the house of the bride and knocked on the door. She was obviously expecting them. And if she said, yes, come in, I'll be your bride, then they got married. If she didn't say that or didn't open the door, they couldn't go in. They couldn't force themselves in. Now let's look what Jesus does here, what he talks about. He says, I will knock. He says, I will knock. If there's two things that happens here. Here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. Now two things must happen. You must hear his voice. So your spiritual ears must be open. And then you must open the door. The handle of that door sits on the inside. Jesus is not pushing the door open. The father of the bride, the father of the groom and the groom, is not forcing the door open. They're waiting for the bride to open, for the bride to say, come in. This is what God is doing here. He's waiting for us. He wants a personal relationship. That's what I was trying to say. He wants that personal relationship with you. In one of the other Bible translations, the word eat is changed, and the translation says, he will feast with you. I love that. I can't remember which translation it is, but I read it in one of the translations. Who do you feast with? Help me. Who do you feast with? Eric, who do you feast with? The people that you love. Am I right? We have a feast with people that we love. So God says, I want to come in. I want to feast with you because I love you. That's what this is about. Is to hear the Lord and to open your heart. This is what the new covenant is about, people. It's about God coming in, coming to you as a person. Like he said to me that night in Gaborone, he said to me, I sensed him saying, this is all that you need. And I sat there that night and I said, But God, my machine still doesn't work. So, you might have a tribulation or a trial in your life. You come to this point, and the next morning when you wake up, that problem is still there. That problem is still there. What does God say to us? He says to us, I'll be with you. I am with you. While you're having that trial, it's not going to go away instantly. Tomorrow, you're not going to end up with $1 million in your bank account. I am with you. That's what he's saying. That's what he's saying. I had a couple of months ago, I spoke to a woman who told me a story of when she was a child that an older man molested her. And that she had forgotten about it because it was just out of her mind. She took it out of her mind. And then at some point in time, she started to remember what happened to her as a young little girl, 2-3 years old. An older man molested her. And she said that she sensed that Jesus was revealing that to her. I got confused. And I said to her, you sense Jesus was revealing to you that you were molested by an older man when you were 2 years old. Why did Jesus not stop it? Why was it not stopped? Why did he not stop it? And the lady, it's a young lady today, in the mid-20s, and the lady said to me, but Jesus said to me, I was there. I was with you. It was somebody else's sin, but I was with you. I was with you when that happened. I stood next to you. I stood next to you. There's only one guarantee in the Bible, people. Only one. The Bible says, and we're gonna conclude with that. The Bible says, Jesus says, if you accept me, you will have eternal life. That is the only promise that God gives us. That's the only one. Doesn't say you will have a lot of money. It doesn't say you won't have sickness. It doesn't say you won't have whatever. It only promises that. But Jesus says, in that trial, I'll be with you. That woman that told me the story. In that trial of my computer not working, I am with you. I am with you. So, let us just stand still for a moment and say, so in that trial and tribulations, God is with us. That is what the new covenant is about. That is what the new covenant is about. And I want to ask you tonight or whenever this week, hopefully you have a bit of wine or a bit of fruit juice and not Coca-Cola. Go and sit with the Lord. Go and sit with him and have communion by yourself. And obviously you can have communion with your family. I was alone. So perhaps my example is a bit different. If you have communion with your family, the men here, have communion with the family. Be that person that leads, and perhaps it can become a bit of a tradition, and I don't want to use the word tradition. I don't want to use that word. But I just want to touch on two things before I go to the greatest miracle of all time. Just go to the next slide. This is Psalm 91. Again, Old Testament. Again, Old Testament. Old Testament, New Testament, one Bible. The Old Testament says there, and I'm not going to read through it, that and the whole Psalm 91 is about God's protection. So go and read it again. It deals basically with two areas of life. God says, I will protect you and I will save you. And the next, if you go to the next slide, it says, I will provide for you. So again, if you go to the first one, it says, verse 3, surely I will save you from the foulest snare, from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness be your shield and your rampart. So God is saying to you that there will be snakes, there will be stuff in your life. But he says, I will protect you from it. Like that woman that told me. But Jesus said, I was with you when that happened. We as people say, but God, why didn't you stop it? Why did you not stop it? God, why did you let my computer crash? Now, I always say these things are very personal. You might sit here and say, oh, the guy's computer crashed. So what? That was a trial for me at that point. Just go to the last slide. Now, I had a commentator in the 2 weeks ago. he called this the greatest miracle. Now, the Bible doesn't say it's a miracle. So the heading there at the top is what I heard from a commentator. It's not from the Bible. But it's Luke 23, verse 40 to 43. It's when Jesus was hanging at the on the cross. Now, this is what I want to conclude with, because this is what God gives us. This is the new covenant. Look what he says. He says, but the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. What is that criminal doing there? It's before we go to the next verse. What is he doing? what is that criminal doing there? He is acknowledging his sin. That's what he's doing. He's acknowledging his sin. He's bringing it to the Lord. He's saying, God, I've sinned against you. This is what I've done. You know everything. He's acknowledging his sin. And he's also saying to his mate on the cross that we too deserve to be here, but this man, and he's referring to Jesus, has done nothing wrong. Now, this is why the commentator says this is the greatest miracle ever. Verse 42. Then Jesus says to him, remember me when you come into my kingdom. Into your kingdom. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus says to him, answers him, truly I tell you, today you will be in paradise with me. That's what the new covenant is about, people. That's what the new covenant is about. So I want to conclude by saying, how do you make this personal for yourself? How do you make this personal? My two main points out of my teaching this morning is, beware of the evil one. Beware, because he comes and he just swivels it a bit. And then it looks so the same as the Bible, so the same as the Word of God, but it's not the same. Ask the Spirit, look at that toolbox, go to 1 Corinthians 12 and read again the gifts of the Spirit so that you can discern, so that you can distinguish between what's right and what's wrong. And then go and sit in front of the Lord and just make sure that you will be in paradise one day. If there's any person here today, any person that has not committed themselves to Jesus, because that's all that you need. That's what I heard 3:00 that morning. Doesn't matter what happened to you, that's all that you need. If there's any person, you're welcome to do it now. You can just repent of your sin and say to Jesus that you want him to accept you. I'm going to leave that for you to do on your own. Thank you, and after the song, I'll just close in prayer.
You can stand with us.
Thank you, team. Thank you, worship team. Just to, before I pray, I eventually got all roughly 21,000 files back, all of them. There was not one lost. I'm still not sure how I got it back. I promise you, I'm still not 100% sure how I got it back. But I have it on the machine, and I've got 3 backups now. So yeah, let's just praise the Lord. Lord, I just want to thank you this morning. I thank you that we can come to you, that you are the one and only that we need. Doesn't matter what our problems are. Doesn't matter what happened to us. Doesn't matter what trials and tribulations we've got. We only need you. It's only you that can take our sin away. It's only you that can open that door and let us sit next to the Father. Nobody else. I thank you for that in the name of Jesus. I thank you. Lord, I also want to just pray for 2 people this morning. Pray for Victor Klutter and Wimvaldi, Lord, people that built this church, founding members of this church that are ill, that are sick. I want to bring them to you as well this morning. Not only them, but I'm just thinking of them because somebody asked me for beforehand to pray for them. Pray for each and every member that's here. Today, when you go out, remember that the only thing that you need is that blood of Jesus. I thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Claude. Just a quick reminder, I forgot to mention it earlier this morning. Please join us next week and the week thereafter for a short series that Jan is doing. The theme is, By This We Know That We Know Him. It promises to be quite informative and very blessing. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful Sunday, all. Thank you.